happy Wednesday and welcome to a summer episode of Social Live. I am joined by my next door neighbor, Jules M. Mahan.
That's me, follow me.
Jules, you haven't been on. Jules, Courtney was back for about 2 weeks. 2 weeks in a row.
2 weeks.
2 weeks in a row.
We did not show last week. That is true.
I forgot. Hope everyone had a happy July 4th. Had great barbecue. Drank lots of
beer.
Beer. What else do you want to like? Probably eat burgers, hot
dogs. I got sunburn.
Fireworks.
Fireworks. We're going to have to ask Jeremy what he did on July 4th when he comes on. We're joined by an amazing guest today. You guys probably follow him on Instagram. If you don't follow him now, at Lunch Boys on Instagram. He's going to be here in just a few minutes. And we need to get to all of our breaking social media news. And then stay tuned. We have an awesome giveaway as well. Jules has got the first big update today with Snapchat.
Snapchat? So, okay, this update is pretty interesting. I think this could be a really big thing for Snapchat. It was found in the Android code on Snapchat that Amazon and Snapchat may be partnering to launch a visual search feature that would allow users to press and hold to identify an object or a song or a barcode and more, and then you'll be prompted to see the results for that on Amazon. So this could be a competitor for like the Pinterest lens camera and may really get users using Snapchat more because it's kind of been a dying platform.
Listen, we've been talking a lot about how Instagram is so much better than Snapchat, especially for getting results for brands. I will say we're running a campaign on Snapchat right now for one of our brands that's doing really, really well. So maybe we shouldn't be putting Snapchat down as much. They are doing a lot of testing. I think a big move with Amazon is something that they should be testing out because businesses that are not using Amazon are going to probably go out of business in the next couple of years because that is where shopping is happening. So,
isn't it like 50% of the world's online shopping is on Amazon?
It's probably going to keep going up and up and
up. That's crazy.
I buy everything on Amazon.
That would be a huge partnership for Snapchat, and it could end up rivaling Instagram's shoppable tags, shoppable stories, things like that, if people are like scanning an item of clothing.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know what we didn't announce? Prime Day is this coming Monday. It is time to buy unlimited Echoes, Alexas, all of those products you probably actually don't even need.
Stephanie's favorite holiday. Your favorite holiday.
It is my favorite holiday. It is my favorite holiday.
I don't have an Amazon phone.
What?
I know. I don't use Amazon.
Have we talked about this?
I don't think so. I've been keeping it from you.
That's horrible. So actually, after this episode, I'm going to give you my link so you can sign up.
You're an Amazon influencer.
In theory, I am. Technically, I am. I have an Amazon influencer account, but I don't promote it that much.
You should. You want to know what you're buying.
Well, let me tell you what I'm going to buy on Prime Day. This is what I'm going to buy on Prime Day if it's on sale. I've been waiting for the past few months for Prime Day, hoping I need to buy a doggy camera so when I'm not home, I can watch my dog. And originally, I was going to buy, I think it's a Nest camera.
Then
I started doing research, and there's actually cameras that you can talk to your dog through the camera. So I want to see if any of those go on sale on Prime Day.
And you need it.
And you can drop
treats. Yes, I saw one where you can drop treats, but my dog will eat that one. So I don't know. I think that one's better for cats. I'm just looking for the one where you can talk to your animal.
This is amazing.
Yeah.
Luca would love that.
I think he would love that. All right, next big update. Facebook is testing out AR ads. Michael Kors is actually the first brand to be testing these types of ads right now. So essentially what you're going to be able to do is try on clothing, try on sunglasses, see how couches look in your apartment, all from a Facebook ad, which I think is going to be incredible. I think it's really going to help drive direct sales for brands on Facebook. Yeah. So they're testing with a few big brands right now, and then hopefully this will be rolling out to everyone, to all brands to be able to test.
This is so cool. I remember when we talked about this, I feel like it was like earlier in the year, we were talking that they were testing this, or this may be coming. And I'm not a big online shopper. Like, I like to go in the store, try things on, and like see how it looks before I commit. But this would change my shopping habits.
Do you think, though, if you put sunglasses on through this AR feature, do you think you can really tell how you actually look and feel in glasses from the picture?
I mean, no, but you'll at least get a better idea. And like, that's what I need. That's all I need.
Just an idea.
And like, if I could, I don't know, if the camera's like really good and I'm like looking great, like I would totally
have your own
casual. Yeah, exactly. Yes. Like glam squad day. Let's go shopping on Facebook. That's what I do.
So it will help increase sales for you.
Yeah,
we'll spend one.
Maybe I'll even make an Amazon account. Good part of them too.
It's going to be a big month for you.
Big month. Big shopping month.
We have some Instagram updates.
Yes, this one is really cool. Instagram is testing a new questions feature in Stories. So right now you can ask, there are a few features that are similar to this. So you can say, like, you can do a poll, ask people, like, give them two options for an answer. And then you can also have them answer in an emoji slider. But this will be, Courtney was testing this last night.
So I posted this morning, you guys. So go on my Instagram, at Steph Jill Carton. I asked a question. So far, I've only been asked if I would pick rock, paper, or scissors. If anyone else has messaged me. Ask me a real question, guys. I'll answer anything.
Courtney was putting a lot on her story last night. So basically, you can just post a question on your story, and people can DM you and respond to it, and then you can share the responses back on your story. I think this is super cool, and it kind of reminds me, I mean, it's not anonymous, like those old, certain TBAs or something like that, that was big in, like, middle school, but I think this is really interesting, and it'll be cool for brands, because it's like they can, you know, it's almost like a focus group for all their followers. They can ask them, like, would you like this style? Would you rather this be cut, like a skinny jean or, like, wide leg jean? So that, I think, is going to be really interesting to see how brands and businesses use this.
And brands can just ask general questions. They can just say, what do you want to know about our brand? And then they're getting tons of feedback from their customers right away.
Yeah, it's really, really interesting. I mean, I think Instagram stories have completely changed the platform, and they only continue to innovate.
Yes. And another update that happened, I think it was while we were away last week for July 4th, you can now add soundtracks to your stories on Instagram. And I've been playing around with this feature a lot on Beluga's Instagram account because there's nothing better than watching, you know, a little dog running around with music playing in the background that goes with the post.
It's perfect.
Yeah.
What would you say is his favorite song right now?
His favorite song. He's so many, Jules.
Oh, he's so musical.
He's so many. He must be one. He's not anything like his mom. He says, like, Britney he's a student client. How about this? I haven't even searched for Britney Spears on there.
Oh my God.
All of her music's on there. Someone check and see if Britney's on Instagram. I don't know if they got the
Britney Spears. She is.
But I am going to the Britney Spears concert at the Borgata a week from Saturday. I'll be there, so I'll be playing her music live. I won't have to use the recording. It's for my birthday, that's why I'm going. Well, so many updates this week that we are so excited to welcome to Social Live our friend Jeremy from the Instagram account at Brunch Boys. Yay! Oh,
yeah, I also like that.
Did you just learn everything that was going on in social media? Or
The Instagram stuff I'm usually on top of. The Snapchat thing, I didn't know. So it's good to, I need to know everything always.
Yeah.
So.
Well, you can tune in every Wednesday at 10 a.m. and catch up on all your social media news that you missed. And Joel, what are we giving away right now?
Okay, if you share this episode, you will be entered to win the chance to meet Jeremy for coffee at his favorite coffee place in New York. I'm not going to tell you because we don't want to, like, paparazzi Jeremy and I. We don't need that. We keep it a secret until you win. That's smart, Joel.
Yeah.
But you will have the chance to grab coffee with him and learn more about his Instagram account, how he built his following, and enjoy coffee at one of the best places in New York.
He's going to buy you one coffee.
Just one. Or don't get crazy ordering, you know, side, like, don't get crazy, okay?
Just coffee.
Just coffee.
Start there.
For 15 minutes.
Yeah, I'll have to do it.
Yeah.
So we learned a little bit about you yesterday. You started your career in TV. You worked with Bobby Flay. Mm-hmm. Can you tell us a little bit about how you got started?
Yeah, so I actually started in sports TV, randomly enough. I studied sports management at NYU, maybe a little bit of a waste. So then I've been working in sports media for a little bit, just wanted something else in television. Found my way into food TV, and the first gig I ever did was Sports Cooks America, season 3. And then Bobby playing that show, and he hired me at ESPA. So I ran around with him for years, like at the time did a lot of shows. We were all over the country, all over everywhere. This last really was like this like introduction to food media.
Yeah.
I just felt loved. It was connected to everything I loved anyway growing up. Like, I love cooking, I love food, I love TV. And I grew up watching Food Network. It was just actually being in it that made me like actually like open my eyes and like, oh, this should be what I'm doing.
Yeah, what a great first job.
Seriously.
Yeah, no, it was amazing, but very, very lucky. Like, it's also, I don't know, it's like woke up every day and it's like, wow, like, I have a job that no one else in the whole world has. Which I thought was so cool. I don't know. Yeah.
Great conversation, sir. But now I have a quick coffee plate question.
Okay, sure.
Have you been to Bobby Flay's restaurant at the Borgata? Borgata before?
Which one's at the Borgata?
Body Play, or just Body Play, Steakhouse.
Oh yeah, Body Play. No, I have not. That's not the
Borgata. Sorry, I was going to ask you what the best thing on the menu to order is, so you'll have to ask me about it.
So when you first started Orange Boys Accountant, what inspired you to focus on brunch-related content, and how have you kind of evolved it as the accountant's world?
So the original idea of Brunch Boys was when I was in TV, I was always freelancing big TV, and I had time off between shows, and I'm just someone that can't ever sit still.
Okay.
So 4 years ago, I was like, you know what, I'll make like some brunch videos and like just play with that. Mm-hmm. So the idea wasn't to have an Instagram account at all. Those didn't really exist 4 years ago.
Yeah.
I was making these videos, and Instagram didn't have any 4 years ago. But I think brunch, because I just thought it was a couple things. It was, all right, if I'm doing something on my own, I can't compete with the budgets and the teams that everyone else would have. But what I can compete with is doing something no one else is doing. So I just looked at the landscape and I was like, okay, I love brunch. Everyone I know loves brunch, but no one in media touches brunch. And I knew why, because in my experiences in TV, even 4 years ago, it's completely different. There weren't all these like niche online things producing good content. It was still pretty much the bigger networks. And their audience is middle-earned. And every conversation with brunch would come up, it's always, well, brunch is just New York or LA thing. And when I was like, okay, well, this is my project, and I'm going to produce for me and my friends, I don't really care what's watching.
Yeah.
So I'm going to pick something I know that will work for me. And that's why the brunch. And
when did it start taking off?
After a year, it really wasn't anything. Like, I made a couple of videos going back to work and sort of forgot about it. And there's still work with food. I had the account I'd upload to it here and there, just like whatever, no thought to it. It wasn't until like a year later, two things happened. One, food Instagrams became a thing. I happened to have an account. And two, I was on all these food travel shows. So I was just organically in restaurants all over the country. So I started posting more and more and started like bubbling. And I got home after almost 9 months of just like being on the road for a bunch of different shows. And I just needed like a mental break more than anything from TV. So I had like maybe 15,000 followers, which even back then wasn't a ton, but like a nice amount. And I was like, you know, maybe I should just like play with this Instagram for a couple months. I have all these invites and parties and fun things, and I'll go back to work. And when I decided to focus on, like, all right, well, if I can do this every day, I might as well put like every ounce of my energy into it. And that's what took off. When I had the time to be producing, to think about, to be on it all the time, to really concentrate on it, just exploded.
Wow. How much time do you spend every day responding to comments and questions?
Every second.
Yeah.
even when you don't think I am, I probably.
Yeah. All right, I'm the right method. So you can get back to me.
So
unless I don't want to answer it. No, yeah. I was busy with things. Sorry.
But now that there are a lot more food accounts dedicated to different types of food in different cities, what do you think makes a good food picture and good food accounts stand out from the rest?
Oh, God. I mean, there really are a billion.
Yes.
I mean, I think it's what I've always had, what I've always strived for, is like thinking how to be different, how to be unique, and certainly how to have a voice. And I think that I look at a bunch of food accounts, I'm like, why would anyone follow this? And I ask myself that about my account every day. Why would someone follow me? There's a million other accounts. So for me personally, it's okay, like, brunch focus, that helps, but certainly if I stay for the knowledge at this point. How to background videos, certainly helps. Like, I've been producing for years. This is work I do now on Brunch Boys, in my brain, is still what I did in TV. I'm out there highlighting things that I love and passionate about, and producing content to share that with everyone. Whether it was for Food Network, but now it's for Brunch Boys, that's what I'm doing. Aesthetic helps, like having the consistency in the photos and videos, and truly having a voice. I get that question a lot. People are like, oh, I started a food account. I'm like, how do I grow it? How do I do this? I'm like, just find out what makes it unique. And if it's just sort of okay photos of like okay dishes and you're not saying anything, there's no voice behind you, I ask them, like, why would someone follow you? If you don't have an answer for that, that's step one. Don't worry about what camera you had and lenses and all that other stuff. Think about what's going to make you unique. And I think that goes into what you're passionate about. I think a lot of times, like, a lot of these food accounts, they're not really passionate about food. Like, I literally had conversations with people being like, just wanted free food, so I started an account. Like, well, that's not why I started. That's how I ended the bigger account started. Because I had a real passion to want to share that. I think that comes through. Like, I had questions a lot, like, oh, if you go back in time, would you pick a different thing to focus on? Because, like, I don't know, make more money doing, you know, car and stuff. And I'm like, no, because it worked and it grew because it's organic. It's something that's passionate about. And if I try to fake it, it never will work. So I think that's
really great advice. So let's talk a little bit about monetizing the account. Because a lot of influencers, like you said, they want to start accounts, they want to figure out how to make a career as an influencer, because you can make a career as an influencer now if you're on that deck and focus on it. So what was the process like when you realized, oh wow, I can actually start charging for my content, brands are reaching out to me. How did you figure out that whole process in this whole new world? Because it changes every day.
It changes every day, it changes every second. It just sort of happened. So what happened was, my plan was to take off a couple months and go back to Montreal's, and go back to TV, sorry. And after a couple months, I was like, I really love this, it's growing, this could be something. I sat down with friends who had already quit their job. And she was like, you know, I would do the same thing. Set yourself a date, see how much money you have, and work to that date, and then see what happens. So I saw how much money I had, I knew how long I could live in my apartment without being homeless, with good money I had in savings, and I gave myself that date, which was another couple months. And just what happened organically, people just started emailing me, honestly, like that was it. It's even now, I very rarely do outreach, but it's fine that most of the things that come in, like someone had an idea for some big marketing campaign and they're looking for influencers. When I pitch myself, it's usually more like, hey, if anything ever comes up, well, let's get coffee, let's chit-chat. I'm never really pitching bigger ideas necessarily because I find that there's not there, like, they're holding back to when we come up with what we want. So it's sort of still that way. So like, again, like you have a voice and you put some of the followers helps obviously, but I think that at this point there's so many Instagram accounts that like I would say an Instagram account with 30,000 followers but unique content and a credible voice is way more valuable to a brand than some of 300,000 followers, but like it's lost in shame. So again, so we're going back to okay, having that voice, having that uniqueness about you, having people that really trust you, and then people will sort of find you.
Do you have a dream brand though that you want to work with that you haven't worked with yet?
Asking it all the time. You know, it really comes down to like sort of the things that I'm passionate about, the things that I organically use, and I think it's actually already like happened, which is really cool. Like,
yeah.
I'm saying I'm sort of a master, and like they love me because I went to them. I said I've never owned an iPhone. I'm like the only person in the whole universe.
Yeah.
Like this in your Amazon, I think I get more years of that. Like I've never had an iPhone. They were cool. I got to work with the Yankees, which was just like the coolest thing ever. Like when I worked in sports TV, like I was covering Yankee games when I grew up like the biggest Yankees fan ever. The fact that they made me come to a baseball game and post our food just like blew my mind.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Brand Sports is now like a media company too. You have a YouTube channel, you have guys up on your website.
Mm-hmm.
Where do you see the future of the company going?
It's hard. I mean at the end of the day, as long as I get to keep producing and you know, content, that's what I want, wherever that may be. Instagram is doing a fantastic job of helping me like do that. I think getting myself out there more helps. I think like there's certainly been a shift in a couple of years. When I started Brunch Boys, it was sort of like do that sort of more brands and just food and focus on that. Where even this past year, it's become much more personality driven. People just want to follow who you really are. So the more things like is on camera, the more people are going to put myself out there more. Like that to me is the better thing. And like you know, cameras have posted stuff before. Like it's some stuff with Thrillist, Seamless, IHOP. Most of like that kind of stuff. I think that's fun for me. But to produce bigger and better things. And I think like IGTV could be a great place for that.
Yeah.
So I'm excited for it. Like, I haven't seen anything that fantastic on IGTV yet. I think people are still finding it and still finding the audience. And
it's
I'm certainly still doing that.
Time, I think it's going to take a couple of months.
Yeah, but I think like that could be a complete
major.
Have
you started a channel on there?
Yes.
Okay,
so basically, my strategy with it so far is I'm like, okay, I have this content that has been too specific.
Mm-hmm.
Just because it's more talky and longer, obviously, and all that stuff. I'm like, all right, and then I start cutting that and sort of moving that to IGTV and see what works. So slowly but surely, like, just testing out what are people watching, what are people watching. But I think that could be a huge change. And then, like, there it is. Like, why do I need to post a show for someone else? And it's just my platform.
Yeah.
Like, that's always the best.
always own your own content.
Uh-huh,
100%. Yes. All right, so favorite brunch place in New York City. I know you get this question all the time, but... You can give your top
rating. I'll give you the top ones.
Okay.
Well, I just went to Mimi's Diner a couple weeks ago. That was fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Writing this down.
Yeah.
Mimi's Diner.
It's really, really good. Like, blew my mind. I always love Sunday Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm.
Fantastic. Best pancakes in New York City.
What?
100%.
You've seen
no
it
on
Instagram.
Oh, 100%.
Big,
yeah,
fluffy pancakes in New York City.
You've
definitely
seen it. And Bon Eats. Their bacon dish is insane. And this month, Black Seeds doing their collab with them. They made their bacon.
Yeah,
exactly.
I
went to Bon Eats
for dinner. I will go try brunch.
Yeah, they also have in the Upper East Side one. They do a chilaquiles tater tots, which are made for like the table. So like the bowl is like the size of this table, just like tater tot chilaquiles.
So you need a couple of friends to go with it.
Yeah.
Or your one. Okay, and the most important question I've been dying to ask you this at Cultivals yesterday. I am a huge French toast connoisseur.
Oh, yeah.
Do you have a recommendation of best French toast in New York? I'll take a recommendation for a crepe as well, best crepe, if you have that.
I don't know. Those are two weird ones.
I'm so sorry.
I know French toast isn't so weird, but I find them not all the places to do it.
Yeah.
What's funny is that was one, so we're starting to think I started with the questions thing on Instagram. So I put it up last night, the first time, like, ask me anything. And that was one time I got the French toast thing. I was like, I'll get back to this. I have to think about it. So I guess, stay tuned. I'll put on stories.
Can you tag me so I'm ready to see it? I won't miss it. That's an important one. I love crepes and I love French
toast.
Yeah,
more people should do French toast.
Yes.
It's more, I feel like they sort of go towards pancakes.
I have found one really good place on the Upper East Side by my apartment. And I'm terrible. It's a French restaurant. I'm blanking on the name, so I'll have to get back
Sunny
to you.
Frog?
It's... Oh, now
I'm
about to, let me Google it.
I'm trying to think, I'm just like, wait, I think it's
something
out there.
Wait, French, Upper East Side. hold on. It's L apostrophe, what is it? Oh, here it is, I'm so wrong. That's
I'm not going to try to say that.
Cafe Dulce.
Me, I don't know.
I'll have
a story.
We're going to have a story. D'Alsace. That's the best French toast I have found so far in the city, and I hope you can give me at least one more recommendation. And Joel, do you have one more recommendation question?
Oh, I was wondering,
okay.
When you go to brunch, is it Bloody Mary or Mimosa?
I'll go Bloody Mary.
What's that?
Oh, it's when you take out the vodka and you put tequila in there instead.
You guys are much bigger in elementary days are over. I'm so high.
Well, I always do michelada, which is sort of the same thing, just with the beer.
Yeah.
The most refreshing beer. I think yesterday I had an Atla. It was still hot yesterday. But
Atla
blows my
mind.
It's so good. It's open all day. So, like anytime anyone has a meet with me, because it's not a cheap restaurant.
Yeah,
take me to Atla. Let's go.
Yeah. Noted. Well, thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing all the behind the scenes of what it's like to build this media company. Congrats on everything you've done.
Thanks.
It's really incredible. And thank you guys so much for tuning in today. If you guys want to go grab a quick coffee with this 6'4" I have to be sure
to
get the seat. Yes, he's 6'4". I'm tall here, but he's a lot taller. Share this episode and comment below, because maybe we'll choose someone who comments why they want to have a quick coffee and sweet drink.
You guys don't want to do that.
And we will see you guys next week. We will be celebrating our 100th episode of Social Live. I can't believe it. It's been almost 2 years. 100 episodes next week. We're going to have a lot of special surprises. Some things might be different behind here. You'll have to tune in to see what we have, what Jules has up her sleeve. And we'll see you guys next week. Have a good one. Bye, everyone.